Ramana Maharshi Center for Learning is a non-profit registered society working now for more than 4 decades in the areas of Indian heritage awareness.
Love will disappear where there is an object. And how can I love as something which is apart from me, because I do not understand that which is apart from me? The person may want something, but I may think that that person needs something else and foist it upon that person. Very often in the name of love, we thrust upon our dear ones those things which they do not want, which don't seem to make them happy at that time. But we say, no, it is my love for you which is making me do this. Whereas he who is ever abiding within every one of us, he alone can love us. He knows better than us also what is our greatest need. And what is that greatest need? That greatest need is, of course, to abide ever in the bliss of the Self. So Bhagavan's life reveals to us from moment to moment the marvelous bliss of the Self. Every moment we can see that Bhagavan is in this bliss. The external circumstances have no meaning whatsoever. This is described by Vishwanatha Swami in the Ashtotram, which is also like a biography of Bhagavan, the Ramana Ashtotram, in which he says, Udasinaya Namaha. He is one who is Udasina. He is least bothered about anything. Least bothered, doesn't care a bit for anything. Udasina. But if we interpret that and we say, oh, I am very indifferent to anything, Udasina is not indifferent. It is indifference. But look at the third nama from that. Om Udasinaya Namaha. Then Mahayogini Namaha. And then Mahotsahaya Namaha. Mahotsahaya Namaha. Full of enthusiasm. Full of enthusiasm. Only one who is truly indifferent can be truly enthusiastic. Because there is nothing for him to lose or gain from anything. So we find that Bhagavan is totally indifferent to his own body at all times, totally indifferent to his own body and totally enthusiastic about anything that the devotees want him to participate in. So full of enthusiasm. Whether the child is telling him a story or somebody is reading out their poem, whatever is being done, he participates in it fully. Whether he is cooking in the kitchen or whether he is sharing a packet of peanuts with his 3 friends. Who are those 3 friends? One baby monkey, a baby goat and a squirrel. And he is having a party with them. Each one is giving a peanut to each one of them. He is having 1 peanut each in turn. So he can party with all the animals. He will cry with those who cry, laugh with those who are laughing, fully into the role, whichever role he is playing. So full of enthusiasm and yet completely untouched. Completely untouched. Not having the least trace of attachment to anybody or anything in the world, and yet showering the greatest love upon everybody, being the dearest unto them, more than a mother, kinder far than one's own mother, eendidum annayir perigarul purivoy, kinder than one's mother. Sometimes, of course, we all feel that Bhagavan puts us through some tests, through some difficult times, that he makes us cry. Maybe for our own good he makes us cry, but we feel, sometimes we feel he gives us difficulties to make us grow. But I don't think so, because I feel a mother does not want her child to cry, even to learn something. A mother doesn't want to make her child cry. The child may cry, but it doesn't mean that the mother wants the child to cry. So, Bhagavan doesn't give us any difficulties. He of course will put us through whatever we have to learn, but doesn't mean that we have to cry or feel sad. He keeps telling us, don't cry, there is nothing to cry. See, when his friend Rangan was crying, not crying literally, going through a very difficult phase. First of all he said, Ranga, all this is a dream, don't worry about it. And then he said, see me, how many difficulties I have, to whom can I go and talk about my difficulties? If you see Bhagavan's life, if you see Bhagavan's life, what kind of a life? Nothing actually. From the moment he has come to Arunachala, practically nothing to eat properly. The first bhiksha he got was some 4-5 days old food, some old rice put into some water from many days in a rusted tin with an old pickle in that. That is the first bhiksha offered by Arunachala. And after that also, where sometimes he goes and begs, sometimes Ratnamma comes and gives food to him. But he says it does not matter. Nothing matters, no. Because what then? That bhiksha, it doesn't matter, food doesn't matter. But when that bhiksha he came, he said, this is father's first gift to me. This old rice, father's first gift to me. So, in everything, that absolute indifference, absolute enthusiasm, because it is filled with devotion, filled with love. Love for the divine manifestation and unity with all beings at all times. That is the self. That is our birthright. Bhagavan is telling us, what is he teaching us? He says, this is our birthright, to be established in the self at all times, to be established in the fullness of bliss and peace at all times. That life of Bhagavan is not for us to be amazed as if seeing an object, as if seeing someone else apart from us, and say, that is Bhagavan. He has lived like that, but not for us. So that we may not say this. He actually has hidden his divinity completely, almost. Somewhere it has leaked out. But he has tried his best to keep it hidden. Many people have written that he was absolutely a schoolboy till the age of 16. He did not have a great academic ability. He did not show any divine qualities. And suddenly one day the awakening came. We know it is not true, because he has revealed the secret that he was born with Arunachala's Purana. But why did he play that leela on the 17th of July 1896 in Madurai? That leela of facing death, inquiring into the source of death, finding out who is it who dies. Why did he play this leela? He played that leela to put his stamp on it. Tomorrow, all my devotees will practice this path of self-inquiry. I must bless this path. I must bless it by going through it myself. Everything that my devotees may face, let me bless it. They may face hunger, I will go through hunger. They may face many travails in their lives, so I will put this body through those travails. The physical condition of the body is such that disease will come to it, pain will come to it. Let this body also undergo that pain. Everything, but through all this, he is revealing to us again and again that it does not matter. The external circumstance does not matter. And when we say it does not matter, it becomes the great, the most magnificent story. The moment we say this matters, this event matters, this matters, today this matters, something matters, then it becomes trivial. The moment we are able to say, it does not matter, it is all a big play of the Lord, or it is all a big, simply a movement of pictures on the self, pictures moving on the self, one picture after another, so many pictures since we have been born till today, so many experiences So many pictures, movie after movie after movie we have been seeing. We are all seeing even now, but we do not recognize that these are all just movies which we are seeing. How do they matter? Yesterday, 10 years ago, there were different movies. 5 years ago, there were different movies. There was something which made us sad on that day. There was something which made us happy on that day. And it passed. And today again, we are caught up in some other movie. Tomorrow, are we going to get caught in this movie? How long are we going to go on thinking these pictures are real instead of seeing the light? So, Bhagavan's light is the light. He has come as the light. He was born revealing the light to the blind midwife. He was born on the day of Ardra Darshana when the light of Arunachala appeared before the great gods Brahma and Vishnu. Kanakamma said, who are these great gods? They are nothing but our sense of knowing and our sense of possessing. These are the two impediments in our, these are the two greatest obstacles in our path to abiding in the self. Our sense of needing, I know, I know, I know, and I possess, I possess, I possess. These are the obstacles, but the light appeared before them, all enveloping light. On that day, Bhagavan is born. He is born on a day when it is, of course, the star Punarvasu of Lord Rama is reigning in the sky, but the procession of Lord Nataraja is entering the temple. There is harmony. It is Christmas, it is Ramzan, perhaps. It looks like it could have been Ramzan in that year, whatever it is. But it's a time of huge festivity, huge celebration. The whole earth is engulfed in celebration because Bhagavan is coming. In fact, this indicates that when we get back to ourselves, our life becomes a huge festival. When we turn back to our truth, to our true nature, our life becomes a festival. Not only our life becomes a celebration, that of all those around us also becomes a great festival, a great utsava. That's what Bhagavan shows to us. He says, be a light unto yourself and everything will get done by you that needs to get done by you. He gives us the example of the sun. He says, does the sun ask, does the sun think every morning, does the sun say, my God, I have so many things to do, I have to get up, then once I get up only, everything will wake up on earth. Once I rise, everything will wake up on earth, the plants and all will get their food, the seasons will work, the waters will evaporate from the sea and then they will pour down as rain, the rivers will run, there will be water for everybody on earth. It's only because of me, I need to do this. Does the sun ever think so? Does the sun plan? Does the sun carry out his activities with so much of enthusiasm or zeal? No. The sun achieves all this just by being a light unto himself. So Bhagavan says, be a light unto yourself and everything that needs to get done to you will automatically get done to you. And this is what we see in Bhagavan's life. He is a light. He is a light. When he is born also, he was the light. And through his enlightenment, he showed us how he is the light and all of us are the light.
Brahma.